For probably about the past 10 years now, I have always read and watched everything I can about E3 because, well, I just love video games. So being that I was able to attend E3 2018, not only as a spectator, but as a VIP to certain areas, was honestly really emotional for me. Sure, I've been doing YouTube for a while, and, you know, going into this, I already had at least 750,000 subscribers who liked my content enough to follow me, but it just felt like everything built up to this. And to give you a brief background, I love the Super Smash Bros. Series, and even though I've never really talked about it, I have an emotional attachment to Super Smash Bros. Brawl. My grandfather, who I was insanely close to, passed away due to esophageal cancer in March 2008. And if you could do the math, that is around the same time Brawl came out. Funny enough, he reserved it for me the previous Christmas, so it kind of felt like a last gift from him, and it was really emotional. And during the time my parents pulled me out of school to, you know, mourn the death, I spent those moments locked away in my room playing Subspace. That was my form of coping, and it really sat with me throughout the years. And I know that sounds a bit morbid to start the video off, but I just want you guys to know how emotional this trip was for me. And even though I played 64 in Melee, you have to realize that this game allowed me to fall in love with the series even more. And to take that exact same series from a decade ago and be invited to E3 2018 as a VIP, that is surreal. It's insane. It really makes you look around and say, everything led up to this and I can't believe it's here. Anyways, my video over E3 2017 was sectioned off by the companies that did their announcements, and I'm just kind of going to ignore that and just list off games one by one. But first, let me give a brief sentence over each conference. Microsoft kept announcing new things, and when I thought they were done announcing new things, they announced new things. Very good conference, probably the best of E3. EA, who really cares? Bethesda, not a huge fan of their company, but they actually did do some things I was interested in. Square Enix. Ubisoft, sure, why not? PC Gaming Show, who knows, I didn't watch. Sony, that's Spider-Man. Nintendo, pretty good if you like Smash Bros. Speaking of Smash Bros, remember Bayonetta 3? Cause Assassin's Creed Odyssey. That's a game. They didn't really show us anything here, but I just really wanted to be known that this was the comeback nobody asked for and the comeback nobody expected. This isn't really anything new, but I at least wanted to be known that Crash Bandicoot is on the Switch. So, Smash Bros? Cuphead was a beautiful game, in more ways than one. Visually, aesthetically, musically, and of course, difficulty. Some could say it's even like the Dark Knights, you feel alone after everyone has left you. But the delicious last course is a very clever play on words of, you know, downloadable content. And they're also allowing us to play as Miss Chalice, which, by the time this video has been recorded, has loads and loads of porn made of her since this announcement. So yeah, expect content on that. When this game was first teased, we really took nothing from it except funny baby giving thumbs up. And now, I still don't really know what it's about. Devil May Cry 5. This is something I did not expect. This is a game series I have watched my friends play and watched my friends gush over for about the past 10 years or so, but also a game series I have not given myself a fair chance to play. So with this new game coming out, I will probably dive into the series itself. Because, you know, having a new game comes out kind of gives me a purpose, something to play for. So I don't know if you guys want to see live streams of that or how you want me to go about playing the whole series, because I also do want to play through the entire Metal Gear series as well. So those might be two games to see on live streams, because I don't really know how to make content for either of those. I just kind of want to play them, you know? What happened to Fallout 5 through 75? This game looks fine, sure, whatever, but I really want to compliment the delivery during the presentation. Todd Howard kind of strung us along the whole time. They were like, hey, look at this game. Hey, it's Fallout. Oh, by the way, it's completely online. Because a lot of people would have heard that's all online and kind of stopped caring. But they hooked everyone in, giving them what Fallout really is. And then they say, by the way, here's a new way to explore the game. Could you kind of twist it to make it sound like a battle royale? Sure, why not? Everything's a battle royale nowadays. Fallout 76 just kind of looks like mayhem with no real intention. I can watch my friend build a house and destroy that house. This is a game about soccer. Fire Emblem Three Houses. This is a game I'm very excited for. During the Direct, I kind of tuned out everything Fire Emblem related because I was too excited about Smash Bros. Ultimate. But the thing about Fire Emblem is that it's all about the story and the characters you meet, so the trailers honestly don't do too much for me because I'm just excited to play through the games itself. Everything that makes Fire Emblem is all below the surface, you know? So I'm really excited to play it. I'm really excited to play a Fire Emblem game on the Switch. I honestly forgot about that until just now. It's not on the 3DS, thank God. So this isn't really about Fortnite coming onto the Switch. I just wanted to share you guys this tweet of ESPN asking where LeBron James is dropping because, you know, they're just hip and young. You guys like Fortnite? Oh no, what the fuck? Oh, well that's not too bad after all. Oh my gosh, let me talk about this. When I talk about my love for Smash Bros. Brawl and all stuff like that, Halo 3 comes in a close second. That is what all of my friends played before Xbox Live dug its own grave by adding party chat. Back in my day, you had to play in the same game as your friends if you wanted to talk to them, and that's why Halo 3 was so fun. I haven't really kept up with the other series, but the thing is, I was equally excited about each subsequent game. And hey, Halo Infinite is coming to the PC, and that excites me more than anything. Yo, let me talk about Jump Force. I actually got to play this game in the Bandai Namco room. This game looked very alright to me on the trailers. We didn't really see gameplay, and the trailer announced the game, so I really did not expect a playable build at E3, but boy was I wrong. The game was beautiful, like surprisingly so. Like Square Enix tears of beautiful. My biggest problem with it, I said it before, but the game was almost too cinematic. Every hit was a spectacle, and it was honestly a bit distracting. Not even that the characters looked good, like the environments were stunning. Everything in the game was beautiful, and that's all I gotta say about it. Holy shit! So the other day, I was going through my old Twitter account before, you know, I deactivated because this account's from high school and I don't want anyone finding that. But I found a tweet on that account that said, Kingdom Hearts 3 was just announced. You know when that was from? June of 2013! I have been waiting for this game for the past 5 years. Well, Alpharad, that's not too bad for a game. I finished Kingdom Hearts 2 in 2005. It has been a painful 13 years, okay? And it's gonna be a painful 14 by the time I get to play the game. Sorry, I just needed to let that out of my system. If I could go back and never play the series, I very well might have. But you know what? I'm in too deep, I've played every game multiple times, and I just have to wait like everybody else. Kingdom Hearts 3 has been a ticking time bomb inside my heart for about the past decade and a half of my life. The trailers were very good outside of the part where, you know, they forgot to add sound effects outside of Sora breathing. We learned a lot about Elsa being in the game and how Sora is stunned that she can use ice powers even though he's been doing that since the first game. Kingdom Hearts is honestly the reason I decided to break this up into games outside of conferences because each conference announced something new about Kingdom Hearts 3. The most notable things being Kairi and Axel sitting together, Riku and Riku sitting together, and Aqua. Oh, Aqua, what'd they do to you? Why? Why does that have to happen to you? So for those of you who don't know anything about Kingdom Hearts 3, this means that Aqua is not the Aqua we know and love. She was once a good girl, and now she's a bad girl after being trapped in the Realm of Darkness or something like that. If you want to look at the very complicated timeline of Kingdom Hearts, and trust me, the games in the series did not release chronologically, Aqua was around for these few games, and then we don't really know where she's been. So Kingdom Hearts 3 has a lot to reveal about Aqua's timeline, and I'm really excited to see how she ended up here. Axel is probably that character you don't like at the start, and then the more games you play, you realize he is one of the most lovable characters in the entire franchise. To see him hanging out with Kairi makes complete sense, but again, it's one of those things we have to see how it happens. And then Riku and Dark Riku, I'm just not gonna ask any questions because I honestly do not have any insight on this one. I was surprised to see the Pirates of the Caribbean come back, and I don't know. The more I talk about this game, the more it hurts me on the inside. Just know, I'm really excited for this game. You guys remember how I did a broken up Odyssey playthrough on my channel? I'm probably gonna do the exact same with Kingdom Hearts 3 whenever that comes out, so be expecting that, cause I might cry. So this game is honestly one of the best games I have played on the Switch. I hate that it's true, but it's probably in my top three of games on the entire console. And also in my top 10 games I played in the past year. Would this game be more marketable to people like you if rabbits weren't in it? Yeah, probably, but that's not how the game was made. Just trust me that this game is really good, so you just need to give it a chance. Also, I've already played through the DLC and it is very good. They introduce a lot of new mechanics that weren't in the base game, and I really like it when games do DLC and the expansion isn't just another world in the same kingdom. They take what exists in the base game and they add new mechanics and features to it that you flat out would not have seen in it. It's not like they just gave us new maps or something like that. They gave us new characters who interact with the environments completely different than any other character would. So this DLC gets an A+ from me. Be sure to try it and just try the game if you haven't yet. Mario Tennis Aces. They didn't really announce anything new at E3 as far as I know. I guess recently, if you want to include this, they announced three new characters to come out in Tennis Aces, which I'm excited for, I guess. It's just kind of a tennis game, so I don't really care who's in it. Like, the characters don't really change anything for me, unlike they wouldn't Smash or something. But cool. Welcome to tennis, Diddy Kong. Mega Man 11 is a game that's kind of cursed. Like, I'm sure the game's gonna be fine and I'm sure people are gonna like it, but it just got such poor reception initially because it looks like Mighty No. 9. And if you don't know, that game kinda just was not good. Mega Man 11 will probably just be okay. It won't be great, it won't be bad, but it'll probably be okay. But everyone's gonna assume the worst of it just because it looks like Mighty No. 9, and that's just the evolution of video games, honestly. My Hero Wants Justice is phenomenal. It really is. I made a whole video talking about this because I felt like this game was worthy. This was the most surprising game for me at E3. When you look at the game, it just looks like a Naruto clone. Like, you know, just the game you played as a young kid where you just mash buttons and hope you beat your friend. That is it. That's all I expected. Take this for what it is. It felt like Pokken without the phase shifts, and the visuals were just much more dynamic and immersive. You got to use the environments to your advantage just with a much cooler cast. What I forgot to mention in my video over this game was that if you watch the anime or read the manga, you know what you're getting into. Like, I felt like I knew each and every character's moveset when I hopped into the game my first time. The movesets just do each character justice, and it's just really cool to see that happen. This is one of those games that's kind of iffy on how much content I'm going to make because I'm very excited for this game, but I don't know if it's something my fan base will really care about. So I'll be doing a lot of footage at the beginning of the release of this game just to kind of test the waters, and if people like it, I'll continue doing more, and if it gets low views, I'll probably just play it in my spare time. But hey, if you're excited for this game, be sure to watch my content, help support me, because, you know, then I'll give you more content you like, and that's how it works. Anyways, yep. Octopath Traveler is a game I feel like everyone else is excited for, so I should at least talk about it until so people don't ask where it is. This game looks very good. The art style is very unique, and the presentation is beautiful. The only problem is I just don't feel like it's the kind of game for me, so you're probably not going to hear me talk about it too much. Ori and the Will of Wisps, it just looks beautiful. Sorry, that's all I got to say about it. These two games look fine. I think Pokemon Company has a beautiful market plan. They made Pokemon Go to attract all these casual fans. They're making a hybrid of the core Pokemon games and Pokemon Go to attract those casual to this game. And then when those casual players are attracted to that, then they release a new core game and they just created a whole new fan base. So Let's Go Pokemon isn't really my type of game specifically, but I completely respect it because they are doing something great. Will I make content on this game? Absolutely. Looks like I would at least have fun playing it through the first time, so I'll record that, and that's probably all I'll really do for it. Okay, I'm actually going through a list right now of games that were announced at E3, and Roller Coaster Tycoon on the Switch? Did I miss this? Is my childhood on this console? Another game I played in my childhood religiously was Spider-Man 2 for the GameCube. This is one of those games where I feel like everyone felt like they were the only one who played it, but almost everyone I've ever talked to has played it for some reason. I don't know why. I feel like this game will be fun as hell. It's like how the best parts of Grand Theft Auto were not actually the story, but just flying around the city. That's exactly what Spider-Man looks like, and I am very excited for that. Spyro is one of those games, which is pretty much what Crash Bandicoot was for me this time last year, where I never played it. I was kind of raised as a Nintendo kid, to nobody's surprise. But Spyro is definitely something I'm really excited to play because I love Crash Bandicoot, so you know what? It's just another trilogy to get myself involved in. Strange Brigade was actually pretty cool. I liked the concept of this game a lot, and it was actually a sponsored video for me to make as well. So it's really dope when you have something coincide with something you like and something you're sponsored for. Oh, Smash Bros. Ultimate. I already talked about this earlier, but I'm going to talk about it again. It is so good. I am so ready for this. Just watch any other video, but oh, this game is going to be good. Even though Lin's an assist trophy. So even though I said the Nintendo Direct was a little bit lacking, my two favorite Nintendo series are Smash Bros. And Mario Party. So it was a good Direct for me, but I have to realize from the outside looking in, it wasn't the best delivery. They got rid of the car. I don't really like that they were custom dice per character. I don't really like rolling 1 through 6 instead of 1 through 10. But hey, that's something I can look past. I also think it's weird that Bowser's a playable character and stars cost 10 coins, but the minigames look really cool. And you know what? I'll settle for it. Why not? I haven't really seen anyone talk about Team Sonic Racing, but I don't care for it at all. It looks like Sonic Transformed All-Stars Racing and Friends and Knuckles, but worse. I don't really know what to think of this. I'm sorry if I'm missing the point, but that's all I gotta say. This is a weird game to make my list, but I love Tetris, and I'll play Tetris Effect. Sure, why not? I mean, it's Tetris. And I'm so happy to end this video talking about Xenoblade Chronicles 2. Looking back, as much as I loved Odyssey, I think Xenoblade 2 might be my game of the year 2017. I might have to retroactively fix my list, but Xenoblade 2 was just so damn good. Actually, Alpharad and Xenoblade, it's fine, you guys know what I mean. Language is just a way to convey what you feel, but as much as I loved the game, I had so many questions after it. Not saying that the plot wasn't conclusive, but there's just so much in the world left to explore. So instead of just giving us another expansion, they just gave us a new fucking game. I do not deserve this. And the best part is my girl Mithra should be with us for the whole game. Thank you, E3. So all in all, I felt like E3 was a bit lackluster in some departments. I feel like the Microsoft conference just hit it out of the parks, and then Nintendo was probably second to do that, and I still don't think Nintendo was great. They announced two of my favorite series, so if you want to go for personal bias, I feel like Nintendo just won it. But going on a more objective standpoint, I feel like Microsoft definitely had the strongest conference for the widest variety of people. But I'm just happy to see a Nintendo console that looks worth it. Smash Bros. Looks great. Super Mario Party looks good enough. And I'm getting a brand new Xenoblade game. Kinda. So on a personal note, I would like to thank each and every single one of you for just being a fan and watching my content, especially for the ones who have made it this far. Because in the beginning of the video, when I say that this was a very emotional trip for me, I kind of had the surreal realization that it wouldn't have been possible if not for you. Without the fans, I never would have been invited as a VIP to play Smash Bros. Ultimate in a back room. Just stuff like that, it's crazy to me. I don't want to say I would be nothing without you guys, because I did work very hard to get where I'm at. I have spent countless hours on making content for you to enjoy, but at the same time, where would I be if I didn't have people watching? So as prideful as I am with my own content, I still have to give you guys the credit you deserve, because you made this happen. Every single day of my life, every time I buy lunch, every time I pay for my car payment, every time I pay rent, I realize that I would not be where I am if it wasn't for the fans. My channel is growing more and more each and every day. We are currently at 800,000 subscribers, which is way more than I ever would have guessed. I had dreams of becoming a million sub channel, but that just sounds so hard, and the closer we get, the more realistic it sounds. And I get emotional when I think about it. I'm not really an emotional person, and I haven't really been at all for the past couple of years, but lately it's just been coming out of me in bursts. This is gonna be a crazy year for me. I got invited to E3 as a VIP. I might hit a million subscribers on this channel I've been working on for 4 years now. Super Smash Bros. Ultimate is coming out in December. I became the creative director for a giant esports org. And to top it all off, I'm getting married in November. So this is going to be the best year ever. I really can't think of any subsequent year that could possibly top this. So thank you guys for being here in 2018, the greatest year of my life. I'm so happy for all of my friends, families, loved ones, and Fiorella for supporting me. You know, she's kind of my rock. She is the greatest person I've ever met. And you know what? You could follow her on Twitter if you want. Like, it wouldn't hurt. She just kind of posts embarrassing pictures of me, reaction gifs, and pictures of our cats. So if any of that interests you, feel free to follow her. She's incredible. But with that being said, thank you guys for everything you do. You might say, well, we don't really do a lot, but you watch this channel. And that is all I could ever ask for from someone. So thank you. It means a lot to me. And I'll make it up to you. I don't have much to make up, but I just want to show how grateful I am for each and every view. If you guys want any videos over the games I've mentioned in this video, let me know in the comments, because your influence definitely affects what kind of videos I want. Everyone always tells me, no, just play what you want. But that's not what I want. I want to make the content you guys want. It's something you want and I don't like at all, well, I'm not gonna do it. But I at least want to find a happy medium of things I enjoy making and things you enjoy watching. So your input is very important to me, so let me know in the comments what videos you've liked me making and what videos you would like me to make. If you're excited to see Smash Ultimate footage, let me know. If you're gonna prove my doubts wrong and enjoy My Hero content, then let me know. There are so many things that I genuinely don't know. There are so many things that I get surprised by. When I put out a video, sometimes I'm just surprised when it gets good feedback, and sometimes I'm surprised when it doesn't. So let me know what you want. It really does make the difference. Your voice matters. Not just on this channel, just in everyday life. Never forget, your voice matters. So with that being said, this year I will finally learn how to do a proper outro.